Okay, so let's start with this second part of the today's presentation. We're going to focus on random access algorithms, actually on enhanced design of random access algorithms. So I'm going to speak about fuzzy log, and if the time permits, also about tree splitting. The first thing is that the first topic is code is learned aloha. And I don't know if Petar mentioned something about it yesterday. So it's a version of Flooded Aloha that's enhanced with success interference cancellation. First, we're going to start with a brief recap of Flooded Aloha, or the most important results. And then in the very first the very first notion that should be clear here is that the results that I'm going to present are not about bits per channel use, which we had so far. So this capacity and per user rate, it was about bits per channel use. And the design of random access algorithms is typically decoupled from this, from the notions of user rate and capacity. And we treat the packets that users are using as atomic units of communication. So there are some bits in it. What these bits represent, how many bits there are, it's not concern of the for the random access algorithm. So somehow we are here. We have medium access control layer perspective. So physical layer and what's going on the need is not really taken into account, or it's actually taken into account, but through very abstract and rudimentary models of the performance of the physical layer. In this sense, the model of the physical layer, the basic model, and mostly and most widely used is the collision channel model. So it's a kind of a, let's say, erasure channel, in which if there is a single user using a slot, sending its packet in this slot, then everything is fine, and by default the receiver receives this packet correctly. And then if there is more than one, so two and more, transmitting something in this slot, then by default there is a collision that is destructive. Kind of erasure happens, so nothing is comes out of this channel uses, and it's waste. This slot is wasted. So collision slot unusable by default, singleton slot usable by default. The basic performance measure here is throughput. Over there we have this capacity and per user rate. Here is throughput, and here we define it as the expected number of received packets and the number of used slots. So we dedicated we dedicate certain number of slots for the random access algorithm, and then we measure how many of these slots were actually meaningful and in terms of that something was decoded over here. So we have the dimension of packet versus slot. And then for the standard slotted aloha, in which we use only singleton slots, the throughput is basically equal to the probability that the number of collided packets is one, or actually it's just a single packet used in the slot. So if capital L denotes the number of the set of the active users and the cardinality of this set is one, then the slot is useful, and basically the probability that happens is the measure of throughput. There have been books published on slotted aloha with backlog, with arrival patterns, backlogs, strategies, optimizations, and so on and so on, and I'm not going to speak about that. But there is a basic result that is very insightful. So if we have infinite population with Poisson arrivals, and the arrival rate per slot is lambda, then this probability is lambda times e to minus lambda. And probably you have seen this before. This becomes maximized when lambda is equal to 1. And then the maximum value of the throughput is 0.37. 1 over e, approximately 0.37. So if there is on average one user per slot arriving, then on average this user will get through with the probability of 37%. So for each slot that we use, we'll have efficiency of using that slot 37%. And that's the asymptotic result that cannot be beaten. The problem is that maybe you remember the curve of so the throughput is basically given as the as function of the offered traffic, and then it goes like from zero, reaches 0.37, and then decays, decreases again. So, but the bottom line is that we would like to operate close to this maximal value, but what will happen sooner or later that will actually the arrival rate, because of the backlog, will surpass this optimum point sooner or later, and then we go to the part of the curve that in which the slotted local becomes unstable. And that's, there are papers that show that no matter what is the, let's say, initial arrival distribution, sooner or later, slotted local becomes unstable. So we have to somehow deal with this problem, typically by declaring an outage for a certain number of users, and then somehow trying to get back into the part of the curve where things become or behave very nicely. A lot of improvements were done over the course of years, and the things became more or less forgotten until some 10 years ago, when successive interference cancellation was introduced into the story of slotted Aloha. And the version of the scheme that was a kind of milestone for all these slotted Aloha with successive interference cancellation schemes that happened afterwards was introduced in 2011 by Gianluigi Liva, and it's called the Irregular Repetition Slotted Aloha Protocol. So we have a frame of slots, and then an active user contends by transmitting several replicas of the same packet that he has. So that's, a user has a certain degree, the number of replicas that are transmitted, and this degree is chosen randomly and independently from all other active users from the same, using the same probability mass function. So there is a probability mass function that says, okay, you will transmit two replicas with probability 0.12 and five replicas with probability 0.17 and so on and so on. And then each user randomly and independently rolls the dice and chooses degree and then transmits a certain number of replicas. Each replica has a pointer to all the other replicas. So it could be a kind of, let's say, seed of the random number generator. And then users contend in these slots of the frame, and the slots are buffered. Decoding starts from singleton slots. So as in typical slot Aloha, first we identify singleton slots and then recover the transmissions from these singleton slots. When a transmission becomes recovered, the pointer is also recovered, and then the base station now learns where the replica has occurred. Can go to this slot, apply interference cancellation, remove the replica, and then maybe this collision slot will become a singleton slot. If the slot became a singleton slot, then a new transmission could get recovered, learn maybe where the replicas of this transmission occur. Base station can go to these slots, remove replicas, and so on and so on. So basically, we have this successive interference cancellation going on the decoding as the decoding process. Of course, it's not easy to do interference cancellation, but it can be done. It actually was so this type of scheme was standardized for satellite communications. Certain parts of the protocols, certain protocols that are used in satellite communications.
So that means for our purposes, for massive communication, is not applicable because it doesn't scale, right? You have to do this iterative decoding for a large number of users.
True. However, if you are able to keep the collision size, if you are able to control it in certain way, at least statistically, so to have like say two, three collided users per slot, and if you are able to do channel estimation all these things sufficiently well, then it would make sense.
Okay.
The number of slots should scale with the number of users, and that's you cannot beat that. But if you are able to pack these slots in such a way that the collision size is a kind of limited,
so the difference cancellation
yes,
is limited.
Yes, then you can do something.
Okay.
So, a simple example, artificial example, of course, but four slots, three users. In standard slotted Aloha, only this slot is useful, and the throughput would be 1/4. However, in coded slotted Aloha, once this replica becomes decoded, base station can go to slot number one, which was buffered, erase the replica, recover this transmission, learn where the replica occurred, go over there, erase it, and then, finally recover this one. So the throughput here becomes 3/4. Obviously, much better result. To make things more complicated, there is also a general version of the scheme, coded slotted Aloha in its true sense, let's say. So the idea is not to transmit replicas of a packet, but we segment packet into segments and then use a linear segment oriented code. So we have some input segments and we produce some encoded segments and then we transmit these encoded segments. Code is available from some code book, that is set of codes that is known a priori, and there is probability mass function governing the choice of these codes. So there is a packet, there are certain number of segments, which the number of segments are fixed, but the number of encoded segments depends on the chosen code, and then we transmit these segments. The idea over here is to achieve rates which are above 1/2. So if we are transmitting replicas of a packet, then the rate is 1/2 or 1/3 or whatever is the number of replicas. Here we can have, let's say, three segments and then four encoded segments. So the rate is 3/4 or 5/6 or whatever. So we have a kind of, let's say, more freedom in choosing the rate of the MAC layer code. And then, going on, so the rate of the scheme, that's what I already mentioned, the number of original segments versus the average number of encoded segments, which is in the IRSA, 1/ number of replica, average number of replicas. And there is also load of the scheme. How many slots are there, and how many active users are there? That this could be also understood as the, let's say, load in terms of innovative packets, because every user transmits a single packet, actually segments and codes and transmits encoded segments, but this is the number of packets versus the number of slots, basically. So it tells us how much we are, how much information we are pumping in into these slots. And this tells us how many, let's say, how much redundancy we actually use to transmit this information in these many slots. So, sorry, yes?
And in these schemes, each UE only transmits the encoded segments
yes.
only once?
Yes, only once. So each segment is transmitted once. But it's assumed that the segments have pointers to other segments, which are from the same original packet.
Sorry, I didn't get the point. And now each segment is included as different encoded part of the message. Yeah, is this true? Or
so each segment, encoded segment, is a mini packet.
Yeah.
And then there is a pointer telling where the other segments are. Okay.
Okay. Yeah.
And then the idea is to collect, for example, if here we had three, and then we have three original segments and four encoded segments, and then any three out of these will recover this original message, and then the fourth one is cancelled through interference cancellation. So that's the idea. So these should happen in singleton slots, or the slots that became singletons through interference cancellation, and then the fourth one can get erased.
If I got it right, you use, let's say, mini slots for this.
Yes,
right?
Yes, yes.
Not the dial.
Not the dial. Yeah. So we call it
slices.
Slices. So, but the number of slots is kept, let's say, as if you are sending replicas, so just to keep the things consistent. So this is the first generalization, and also you consider generalization of so-called K collision channel. So the standard collision channel model, we could call it one collision channel model. So if there is one, or not more than one, then we can decode what is over there. K collision channel model, if there is not more than K, okay. If it's more than K, then it's a collision. We cannot do anything, but if there is less than K or K, then we can code everything. So idealization of K and PR capability, which could be made, for example, to use PLNC, physical info coding, and signature coding. Okay, so we apply physical info code to get rid of the noise. We observe sum, and then sum is decoupled if we have k out of n signature code. But once again, here we are dealing with packets, so we don't really consider what is over there. But it could be realized, at least ideally, through some kind of physical layer processing. So, as I said, power control equal channel gains, PLNC coding, so removing the noise, and then k out of M should be, this is an error, signature coding. And here is the, converse bound result, which tells us what is the bound on the load that cannot be surpassed if we want to have zero error decoding because of the collisions. So, the idea is to have no unresolvable collisions, or that the probability of not resolving a collision tends to zero. So all collisions are actually exploitable. And then what is the load, how many innovative packets we can pump into certain number of slots in order to get all what is in to get out. That's basically the idea. So converse means that there are no strategies that can perform above this bound. I'm not going to go into details. So this bound on the load, call it capital gamma. And what we do, we also divide it by k. So going back to what I said before, k, in order to have signature, k out of m signature coding, the number of resources has to scale with k. So the idea here is to divide by k, because we have to invest k times more in order to have k collision channel. So the idea is to see if this ratio grows, stays the same, or decreases. If it stays the same, that means that there is no sense in having k collision channel instead of one collision channel. No sense to invest resources because the performance stays the same. So you're just performing k times better, but when you normalize, it's the same thing. If you perform worse, then it's actually a problem. If you perform better, then it means that investing in k makes sense, because you are achieving loads that are higher. And here is the graph that shows this bound. So this is the rate of the scheme, what is the amount of redundancy that we spend on sending a packet. So how many, for example, on average encoded, so how many original segments versus the number of encoded segments on average. And this is the bound of load on load divided by k. And then we can see that it actually grows. So the upper bound is 1. You cannot resolve more than k packets on k collision channel model on slot basis. So that's what you can do, on average, of course. And then, as we increase k, the bound on asymptotically achievable load increases and tends somehow to fill up this to reach the upper bound. Of course, so we didn't prove this, but probably it could be proven that it will go to 1. But it makes sense. As k becomes very large, then whatever you send, no matter how many you send in the slot, it will resolve them because k is very large. So it intuitively makes sense. But it also shows that actually it grows pretty nicely as k increases and is, let's say, some kind of realistic values, which are not very big. And there is also a strategy that asymptotically achieves the bound. So this coupled, spatially coupled, what is called the Aloha, which is described in this letter, shows that this bound is meaningful. So increasing k from 2 to, let's say, 3, you will actually gain something in the load of the scheme. So let's say that here, this result here shows that the bound and the not the bound, but that investing in, once again, investing in k NPR makes sense, at least in this idealized scenario.
You discussing this paper there, how you scale k is based on the Sieber number of antennas, things like this.
So we don't go in, so we say we have a k collision channel model. We don't really talk about it. One way, as I said, could be power control, PLMC, and signature coding. Of course, we have very idealistic representation of all these building blocks. Another thing, maybe, that you have a way to have this MPR could be using orthogonal codes, spreading sequences. So somehow, magically, all these active users have orthogonal sequence, and then you're able to remove the interference if there is up to k of them. So,
that's not international.
Yeah, so we give it in the paper how this result is achieved. It's an artifact of endorphin re-evaluation and also exit analysis, exit charts. These are the tools of used for analysis of codes on graphs. So maybe didn't mention that, probably not. This success interference constellation is the same thing as iterative belief propagation erasure decoding of codes on graphs. And all these results are basically motivated from the, and used from the coding theory. So there is a very nice analogy between, let's say, codes that are used for erasure channels and slotted aloha that is performed on the collision channel model. And we published a lot of papers on this topic, but as I said, we don't have that much time, so we're just going to cover the basics. Another topic about enhanced design of random access algorithms is related to the, let's say, better modeling or more appropriate modeling of the physical layer. So, collision channel model, typically used model, is useful when SNR is high enough, so the noise is removed. The powers of interfering signals are close to each other, and the receiver can perform only single packet reception. So that could be maybe a case in satellite communications. However, in reality, the impact of noise cannot be neglected. So a singleton slot is not decodable by default. And also, there are significant variations of the receive power, especially in terrestrial wireless communications, due to fading. And it may happen that some of the received signals is much stronger than the other interfering signals in the slot. And then this one can actually capture the slot and become decoded. Unfortunately, there is not one, but many models of capture effect, and it really depends on the physical layer operation. One of the frequently used models that is very nice in terms of analytical use is the threshold-based one. So, some user, U, can capture the slot if the power of his transmission at the point of reception is B times, at least B times stronger than the power of the noise and the interfering transmissions. So if SINR of this user is above some threshold, then it's for sure decoded, and if it's below this threshold, then for sure it's not decoded. So it's a kind of a step function where SNR has a threshold that is equal to B. So B is called the capture threshold. Not an ideal model, not so it's a kind of abstraction, again, but it's better than the collision channel model, because here we actually try to see what is the SNR in the slot. In this model, so basically this is standard assumption, this is a Gaussian noise. And then somehow this model assumes that this is also a Gaussian process that is independent of the noise. Although limited, this model is frequently used in practice. And also, for example, RFID, literature on RFID assumes a threshold-based model. Papers on ZigBee also assume threshold-based model. And it's also for, let's say, mobile cellular networks, it is also frequently used.
My main concern is about modeling of the interference. I guess it's an implication of the law of large numbers, let's say.
Yes.
Use this Gaussianity.
Yes.
But since we are saying that we have different powers, then the geometry and the power plays a role in interference, because a strong interference has, you know, a large power and is closer to you, creates a different interference than someone who is has less power or is more distant. So maybe we need something like, you know, a stochastic process or something to model the interference instead of assuming Gaussianity, right?
Definitely, and as I said, I mean, it's a matter of debate, a huge debate. So there are papers which say that this is not a good model. The nice thing about this is this, it's very analytically useful. So, and as I said, I mean, if you try to...
if you try to model everything, of course, it will be complicated.
That's one thing. The other thing, I mean, in RFID, by default, there is a kind of sensitivity threshold. And it's the same thing. I mean, below that, it's zero. Above that, it's one. I mean, that's what the people assume. So yeah. I'm not saying this is perfect. I'm just saying it's kind of maybe more useful than the equation channel.
Would it make a difference if instead the threshold was like a threshold, but if it was like a probability? Okay, so after instead of threshold,
yeah.
It's
so
not
that, so,
a
so I've seen papers in which this thing, so the threshold also depends on the SNR. So it's not like the threshold is a kind of also random variable. That's one thing. The other thing is that I've seen papers in which, because of all these limitations, they simulate physical layer and say, okay, if the slot degree that's called, or collision size is one, so this is the probability of recovering. Collision size is two, then this is the probability of having one out of these two or two out of these two. If there is three and so on. So the character is the kind of, but then the problem over there is you have to do a lot of simulations for a lot of cases. So I've seen papers that do like that. That would be maybe a more, let's say, a fair approach, but analytically of little value. So another, let's say, idealized scenario, but kind of instructive, is one in which we assume a Rayleigh block fading, and we assume that this Rayleigh block fading, so it affects slot, and it's IID for all active users in that slot, and also we assume that the expected received power for all active users in the slot is the same. So we assume that we have a kind of power control on average. So the expected power is the same. And we have Rayleigh block fading affecting all the users in the same way. And we combine it with this capture model with threshold, in which B is more than one. Then we can assess maybe some kind of throughput performance analytically in a very easy way. I'm not going to go into details. It can be derived, this probability, that a capture effect occurs. So some of the users in a slot with collision size L captures the slot. This is the expression for this model. So the good thing about Rayleigh is the kind of analytically you can manipulate it relatively easily. And then the throughput is actually now becomes a bit more involved, the throughput expression. So the probability that collision size is I times the probability that somebody captured the slot. Okay. And then we get from I to infinity. This is important to stress that this is the case of single user detection. If B was less than one, then you would have multiple user detection, and then it would become a bit more complicated. So we're going to stick to this case. And now, in the case of Poisson arrivals with infinite population, the throughput becomes like this. So this is the probability that we have I users arriving in the slot. And then if we assume B equal to 2 for some reason, which is also used in practice, so SNR has to be more than 2 in order to get for a user to capture the slot, and we assume SNR of 20 dB, then this is the maximum throughput that you can have. So it's not 0.37 anymore, it's 0.43. So capture effect is beneficial. You can do some more with the slot than if you have a collision channel model. And of course, this happens for a different arrival rate, which is 1.2 approximately. So you should have on average 1.2 users per slot, and then you will be able to do much more. Much more, like 20% more. However, you can also plug this capture effect in Kodislav Lavoha, and we did a paper for the version where we contend with replicas, not in coded segments, but with replicas. And again, it's a kind of, let's say, a bit idealized scenario in which really fading is block, but is also IID over slots. So it's affecting slots independently and users independently. And we also are assuming that we have perfect interference cancellation. So we are actually able to estimate what is the channel in some other slot where the replica is, and then we remove the user perfectly from over there. So this is a kind of a, let's say, idealized result, but it gives you some kind of a bound what you can achieve. And then if you couple capture effect with interference cancellation, so you can do interference cancellation within the slot and then among the slots, we can achieve throughput of 1.84 with the same capture threshold of 2 and the same SNR of 20 dB when the load is 1.86. So on average we have 1.86 packets per slot colliding, and on average we can take out 1.84 out of this. So we have some kind of error, which is of the order of 1%, and we allow for this error, but we are able to use almost everything from the slot that we observe. So this is asymptotic result, and we also here show the results which are non-asymptotic. So there are some distributions, so you remember this DV distribution is the distribution that governs the choice of replicas and how many replicas you will send. So we use it in here in the finite length case. So, and this is the characteristic behavior. So as the number of users increases, the throughput as the function of load also increases. So asymptotically it will go to 1.84 and then suddenly drop. This is this kind of threshold behavior which is known for codes on graphs. The bottom line is that capture effect coupled with interference cancellation can give you more than one user per slot on average. So we are able to extract almost 2 packets on average from a slot. And so we started with 0.37, then we had for the same scenario without interference cancellation 0.43. Now we do almost 2. Of course, as I said, perfect interference cancellation, IID really, and so on. Strong assumptions, but a kind of, let's say, result that at least shows that there is some kind of promise in these kind of schemes. I will also go with a single slide on the impact of the finite block length on slotted Aloha. So this is, again, trying to couple, let's say, a physical layer, or to have a better physical layer representation when dimensioning slotted Aloha schemes. So this has nothing to do with interference cancellation and Kodislav Lavoha. This is a general remark on slotted Aloha. So frame slotted Aloha. So there is a frame of slots, and then we assume that in this frame there are n channel uses. And then we have to divide these n channel uses into ns slots, and each ns of the ns slots there will be some ns channel uses. So, if we neglect the impact of the finite block length and use the channel, the collision channel model, then we are basically selecting the number of slots such that the throughput is optimized without any notion of how many channel uses are there in the slot. So, this is the throughput result for the frame slotted Aloha. The probability that there is one user in a slot, in which we have NU contending users, and we have NS slots. So if there are NU users and there are NS slots, then the probability there is a single user active is the probability that one of these NU users selected a slot and the rest of them didn't select the same slot. Okay? And it could be shown that this is maximized when NU is equal to NS, or better said, NS equal to NU. So the number of users, the number of slots should match the number of users in order to maximize the throughput for the collision channel model. Another approach is the one in which we assume, which we consider the impact of the finite block length. This is just, let's say, kind of assessment. So again, it's decoupled, the treatment of physical and Mach layer, but a kind of analysis that gives us some kind of feeling what's going on over there. So the throughput is now the probability there is a single slot in the single user in a slot, but times the probability that a packet in this slot is decoded. So we are assuming that if there is collision of two or more, then we cannot do anything. So if there is just a single one, so what is the probability then that we actually decode this one? And then we combine this result with the finite block length result. I guess Petar probably yesterday was speaking about this. So, and then here, this NS, the number of channel uses per slot, is actually included. So we have this number of channel uses per slot also affecting the throughput. And then, as I said, we cannot choose these two independently because these two are tailored to the total number of channel uses. And the bottom line is that choosing NS in order to maximize one and then choosing NS to maximize two is not the same thing. So again, an illustration of the limitation of this decoupling between physical and Mach layer when assessing the throughput and let's say design of random access algorithms. Okay, are there any questions? Okay, so maybe Anders, you can turn it off. Mm-hmm.